Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Hi, dear students. Hearty welcome to Biology classes of Jnanamarga. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In today's class, we shall continue with the leaf. You have started the morphology of a flowering plant chapter in yesterday's class. Coming to the leaf is a lateral, generally flattened structure borne on the stem. It is a lateral structure, flattened structure. It develops at the node and bears a bud in its axil. It bears a bud in its axil. It develops from the node. The axillary bud, whatever you come across, later develops into a branch. This is the stem part. This is the node part. From the node, the leaf arises, and this leaf may enclose a bud, and this bud may develop into this bud, what is called axillary bud, later develops into a branch, or sometimes it may form the flower also. Leaves originate from shoot apical meristems and are arranged in an acropetal order. The acropetal order is one where the old leaves are seen at the base and the young one at the top. So that is what is called acropetal order. The young leaves, the recently born leaves, are seen at the upper part and the older leaves are seen at the bottom part. So that is what bottom part means, lower part. That is an acropetal order. They are the most important vegetative organs concerned with the photosynthesis. You know, leaves have the chlorophyll. Therefore, these are the most important parts concerned with the synthesis of food. A typical leaf consists of three main parts. Leaf base, petiole. This is what leaf base you have. Petiole and lamina. This is what the lamina you have. So there are three parts. The leaf base, petiole and the lamina. Now, as you know, in my class, I am going through each and every sentence of the NCERT book, word by word. And this is what is required to excel in CBSE board examination as well as the state level CET examinations, board level examinations, so CET level examinations, and also NEET examinations. Therefore, let us study each and every sentence very thoroughly in my class. This is another picture showing you the same leaf. Leaf having the leaf base. And as I said, the leaves arise from the node. This is the node. This is another node. And in between you have what is called internode. And you do come across a bud. And this bud is called axillary bud. And generally it gives rise to the branches. And in the leaf, you come across a leaf base and petiole. And the other part of the leaf that is known as leaf lamina. You can see two different types of leaves here in this particular picture. The same thing. Again, you can see that. So this is what you have in your NCERT book. Right? Now, let me tell you about these two other two diagrams in my next part of the lecture. The leaf is attached to the stem by the leaf base and may bear two lateral small leaflet structures, and these leaflet structures are called stipules. You come across, this is the leaf base and these are the stipules. These you can see the stipule here, another stipule is there on the other side. There are the leaf is attached to the stem by the leaf base and may bear. It is thought that there should be compulsorily these structures, may bear two lateral small leaf-like structures called stipules. In monocotyledons, as exemplified by wheat, rice, etc., in monocotyledons, the leaf base expands into a sheath covering the stem partially or wholly. Look here. This is what you have, the monocotyledon. And this is the monocotyledon base. And this leaf base of the monocotyledon, it expands and it forms a sheath-like structure. And this sheath, it surrounds fully or partially the stem part. So here is the leaf base forming a sheath covering the stem fully or wholly or partially. And this is what you have here. This is the dicotyledon. It is not seen in dicotyledon. This leaf sheath is found covering the stem in only monocotyledons. As you can see here also, each base forms the sheath-like structure, right, in that of the monocotyledons. In some leguminous plants, the leguminous plants that you are aware of some of the examples which give us this dal, tur dal, or which gives you the pulses. In some leguminous plants, the leaf base may become swollen. Look here, the leaf base is swollen. Leaf base is swollen. You can see here also. Leaf base is swollen, and such a swollen part of the leaf is called pulvinus. You must remember that the pulvinus, it is nothing but swollen leaf base, and this is characteristic of leguminous plants. This pulvinus is different from what leaf sheath you have seen earlier. Leaf sheath is seen in monocotyledonous plants, and this leguminous plant is a dicotyledon. In some leguminous plants, the leaf base is a little bit swollen, and this swollen leaf base is referred to as the pulvinus. The petiole help hold the blade to light. We have seen in the leaf the petiole, and petiole enables the blade to get exposed to the light. Long, thin, flexible petioles, yellow, leaf blades to flutter in wind, thereby cooling the leaf and bringing fresh air to leaf surface. In many of the plants, there will be long, thin, flexible petiole. And because of this long, flexible petiole, the leaf always will be shaking. And this fluttering, these leaf blades, they flutter in the wind. And by this fluttering, the leaf gets cooled, bringing fresh air to the leaf surface. The lamina, this is what you have seen, the lamina. The lamina, or which is otherwise called the leaf blade, is a green expanded part of the leaf with the veins, what you see here, with the veins and veinlets. Veins and veinlets. There is usually a middle prominent vein. This is what you have. Very prominent vein in the middle, which is always referred to as a midrib. Midrib. And these are all lateral ribs, lateral veins what you have. Lateral veins. And this is the mid vein, very prominent vein. And this prominent mid vein is called mid rib. Veins provide rigidity to the leaf blade and act as a channel of transport for water, minerals, and food material to the leaf. So, what is the significance of this mid rib, or what is the significance of this veins and veinlets? The significance of this, or what is the function of this mid rib, vein, and veinlets? This midrib or mid-prominent vein, the vein, other lateral veins and the veinlets, they are all concerned with the transportation of water, minerals, and that of the food materials to the leaf or lamina. The shape, the margin, the apex, and the surface, and extent of incision of the lamina varies from plant to plant, or in different leaves. So, it is not that the lamina is the same, the apex is the same, the margin is the same, As you know, if you look into the mango leaf is different from that of the pineapple leaf, or this is different from that of the sapota leaf, or this is different from the leaf of the jackfruit. In this way, you do have the leaves to look differently in their shape, in their margin, in the apex, surface, and also in the incision of the lamina. Now let us look into the venation. The arrangement of the veins, that is the midvein, lateral vein, and veinlets in the lamina of leaf is termed venation. And all these are asked in the board examination for 1 mark question or 2 mark question like that. So the arrangement of veins and the veinlets, you know, veinlets are nothing but minute veins. Veinlets in the lamina of a leaf is termed as venation. When the veinlets form a network, veinlets form a network, the venation is termed as reticulate. This is what you have, reticulate venation, because the veinlets, midvein, lateral vein, and the veinlets, these form some sort of network, and this type of venation is termed as reticulate. When the veins run parallel to each other within the lamina, see, this is a midvein, and these are all other lateral veins. And all these lateral veins, they run parallel to each other. The venation, then it is said to be the parallel venation. You must know that reticulate venation is a characteristic of dicotyledonous plants, and parallel venation is a characteristic of monocotyledonous plants. So these are the basic structure of the leaf. Now let us see what are the types of leaves we have. A leaf is said to be a simple. Whatever you have studied already, these, whatever I explained now, these are all simple. A leaf is said to be simple when its lamina is entire, or when incised, the incision do not touch the midrib. So here you have this leaf. Here, the lamina is entire, and there is no incision, or even if it was small incision are seen, and these incisions do not reach the midrib. So therefore, this type of leaf is said to be simple. Here also, you can see that this is one leaf, and this is a lamina, and you see to some extent that of the incision, but this incision is not so deep to reach or to touch the midrib. So it is there. But here it is not like that. See, there is incision, and that incision reaches the midrib, and it reaches the midrib. So it is not here. It is not in case of a simple leaf. There is no incision which reaches the midrib, and such leaf is called simple leaf. When the incisions of the lamina reach up to the midrib, breaking, here incision has reached up to the midrib, breaking the leaves into a number of leaflets. All these are leaflets. This is one leaf. These are all leaflets. When the incisions of the lamina reach up to the midrib, breaking it into a number of leaflets, the leaf is called compound leaf. So these two are compound leaves, and this is the simple leaf. A bud is present in the axils of the petiole. This is what the petiole have, and you come across sometimes the bud here. Already have mentioned about that. A bud is present in the axil of the petiole in both simple and the compound leaves, but not in the axil of leaflets. So you don't see any bud here in the axil of the leaflets. The bud is seen present in the axil of the petiole in both the simple and the compound leaf, but not in the axil of that of the leaflets or in the compound leaf. The compound leaves may be of two types. What are they? In a pinnate compound leaf, a number of leaflets are present on a common axis. Number of leaflets are present on a common axis. These are the common axis. Common axis. You can note down, you can label, this is the common axis. Number of leaflets are present. Leaflets are present. Number of leaflets are present on a common axis. On a common axis, this is the axis. Number of leaflets are present on the common axis. Now, this axis is referred to as the rachis. Rachis, which represents the midrib of the leaf, as in the neem. You might heard about that. This is of the leaf of the neem. Neem. Okay. So, it is a pinnately compound leaf. In a palmately compound leaves, this is what? The palm-like. Palmately compound leaves, the leaflets are attached at a common point. All the leaflets are attached at a common point. All these are attached at a common point. Here, the leaflets are attached to the rachis. That is the common axis. The rachis, which is nothing but the midrib of the leaf. So, you have pinnately compound leaf. In the board examination, you may be asked, what is pinnately compound leaf? What is palmately compound leaf? Give the difference between the pinnately compound and palmately compound leaf. And in the NEET examination, CEET examination, you may be asked, give an which one is the pinnately compound leaf, or which plant shows the palmately compound leaf, which plant shows the simple leaf, like that. So, in palmately compound leaves, the leaflets are attached at a common point, that is, at the tip of the petiole. This is the petiole, at the tip of the petiole, at the tip of the petiole, as seen in silk cotton. I have given you the example. Pinnately compound leaf is seen in a neem. Of course, whatever examples that are given in NCERT work, you please make it a point to remember. There are so many plants. You can't give all the examples because you might not have studied that. So, whatever you study in the NCERT book, please remember, and you give the example of that example also in examination, that will make you to get good marks. In palmately compound leaves, the leaflets are attached to the common point, that is the tip of petiole, as in a silk cotton. So, now let us see phyllotaxy. What is phyllotaxy? Phyllotaxy is the pattern of arrangement of leaves on the stem or branch. Phyllotaxy is nothing but how the leaves are arranged on the stem. This is usually of three types. Phyllotaxy is generally of three types. What are they? Alternate, opposite, and overlap. These are the three important types of the phyllotaxy. What is phyllotaxy? Or explain phyllotaxy with a relevant example. What is phyllotaxy? What are the types? Explain phyllotaxy with the relevant example. Maybe ask for 3 months question or four. There are usually three types of phyllotaxy. Alternate, this is what you see. Alternate, opposite, and overload. So the three different types of phyllotaxy include alternate phyllotaxy, opposite phyllotaxy, and overload phyllotaxy. In alternate type of phyllotaxy, this is what? Alternate type of phyllotaxy. In alternate type of phyllotaxy, a single leaf arises at each node in an alternate manner. Here one node, one leaf. Here another node, other side, another leaf. One node, this side. Another node, like that, of course, here you have the flower. And like that, you do come across in alternate type of phyllotaxy, a single leaf arises at each node in alternate manner. On this side, another other side. This side, other side. Alternate manner, as in a China rose. I hope you know that China rose is nothing but a hibiscus technically. Or botanically, it is called hibiscus. I'm sure you are very much thorough with this particular flower. China rose or hibiscus. This is what mustard. Here also, you come across alternate phyllotaxy. Mustard, and this is in case of sunflower plant. Sunflower plant also, you do come across alternate type of phyllotaxy. Now, in opposite type of phyllotaxy, look here, opposite, leaves are opposite. In opposite type of phyllotaxy, a pair of leaves arise at each node. In alternate type of phyllotaxy, only one leaf at each node. In opposite type of phyllotaxy, a pair of leaves arise at each node and lie opposite to each other. as seen in calotropis. Calotropis, this is what you have, calotropis, the flower, calotropis the plant, and guava. This is the guava plant, that is Psidium guava. Guava. Psidium guava is the scientific name, and guava plants, you might have eaten these fruits, and in this, you will come across opposite type of phyllotaxy, where in each node, there are two leaves arising opposite or lying opposite to each other. If more than two leaves arise at a node, more than two leaves arise at a node, and form a whorl more than two leaves. More than two leaves. You can see here, more than two leaves arise at a node. Form a whorl. It is called whorled, as in Alstonia. Alstonia is used to prepare some sort of a decoction on particular auspicious day in India. And it is a highly medicinal plant, Alstonia. So, now this is what you have seen, types of leaves. I hope you have understood so far whatever that's taught. Do you have any doubts?
No.
No. Now let us look into modification of leaves. Leaves are often modified to perform function other than photosynthesis. You know, the basic function of the leaves is to help in the synthesis of food or photosynthesis. In many plants, apart from doing the function of photosynthesis, some of these leaves are modified to perform some other function. Let us see what. Leaves are converted into tendrils. You already heard about tendrils in case of the stem modification. They are converted into tendrils for climbing. The function or the help in climbing, as seen in peas, sweet peas, as seen in peas, or into spines for defense purpose, self-protection purpose, as seen in a cacti. You can see here, you have a lot of these tendrils here. These are the leaf-modified structures. Lot of tendrils are present, and these tendrils enable these pea plant to climb. Or you can see that these leaves are modified, as you can make out here, as spines. And these spines help in self-defense, as seen in cacti. Or fleshy leaves in case of onion or garlic, these fleshy leaves store food. We prepare different types of dishes by making use of this onion and garlic. So in both the onion and garlic, the fleshy leaves are involved in storing the food. So, as you can see, the same thing, the leaves are converted into tendrils. In the close-up diagram I'm showing you, the leaves are converted into tendrils, and these help in climbing. And here, they are converted into spines. I'm showing the same in a little bit of more close-up diagrams, as seen in cacti. And this is what you have, the fleshy leaves of onion and that of the fleshy leaves of garlic, which store food. Now, in some plants such as Australian acacia, this is what acacia plant you see. Australian acacia, the leaves are quite small. See here. These are quite small leaves and they are short-lived. That means they fall off. They are short-lived. What do you see the other part? And which appears like a leaf. See, this appears like a leaf. Remember, these are not the leaf. This is the true leaf. This is the true leaf part in acacia. And this, in some plants such as Australian acacia, the leaves are quite small and they are short-lived. That means after some days, they fall down. And the petiole in these plants expand, very much looking greenish in color. They green are in color and they are green in color and they are concerned with the photosynthesis. So you must remember in Australian acacia, it is a petiole which are expanded, and these expanded petioles become greenish in color and they are involved in the photosynthesis. So see here, the term you come across, the phyllode. So many times you may be asked, what is a phyllode? filled as a flattened petiole and two leaves at the tip of acacia. This is what. So you must know down there. We use the term to this flattened petiole, we use the term filled. We are using the term filled. Then leaves of the leaves of certain insectivorous plants, such as a pitcher plant. You can see here, these are all the pitcher plants. The leaves of certain insectivorous plants, such as pitcher plant, it is scientifically called an nepenthes, are also modified leaves. What you see here, these are all modified leaves, right? In the pitcher plant, there are also the leaves of certain insectivorous plants are the plants which eat insects. Whenever the insects come here, enter here, whatever your lid part you see, that closes. The insects will be trapped and they will be digested. And these plants are called carnivorous plants, are also called insectivorous plants. And what you see, these insectivorous plants, the structure in the pitcher plant, that whatever you see, this bag-like structure, they are the modified leaves. And leaves of certain insectivorous plants, such as Venus flytrap, otherwise it is called Dionaea muscipula, are also modified leaves. These are also modified leaves. Where? In case of a Venus flytrap. Scientifically, it is called Dionaea muscipula. Then, Drosera, this is another. I am now giving you a little bit more information, which is not there in your NCERT book, but required for NEET examination. Drosera, commonly known as sundews, is one of the largest genera of carnivorous plants. Sundews, commonly called sundews. You can see there, the dew, whatever that is falling, and it is very clear during the bright early morning. So, these members of the family Droseraceae lure, capture, and digest insects using stalked mucilaginous glands covering their lip surfaces. With these glands, they are trapped. Insects are trapped in Drosera. So, you do have another set of these insectivorous plants. Utricularia, commonly and collectively called bladderwort. All these. Bladderwort is a genus of carnivorous plants. Carnivorous plants, they occur in the freshwater and wet soil as a terrestrial or aquatic species across every continent except Antarctica. Utricularia are cultivated for their flowers, which are often compared with those of snapdragons and orchids, especially amongst carnivorous plant enthusiasts. All utricularia are carnivorous and capture small organisms by means of bladder-like trap. So this is what I wanted to tell you about some of these insectivorous plants. Right? Any more doubt?
No.
Right. Now let us take up the next important part of the plant, that is inflorescence. A flower is a modified shoot. I have already showed you, here, arising from the node, there will be a leaf, and sometimes in between the leaf and leaf base and that of the stem, you may come across axillary bud. And this axillary bud may develop into a branch or it may develop into a flower. A flower is a modified shoot wherein the shoot apical meristem changes to floral meristem. Floral meristem means this is going to form the flower. Shoot apical meristem means it is going to form the shoot. Internodes do not elongate and the axis gets condensed. In these cases, whatever you come across internode, it will not elongate and the axis gets condensed. The apex produces different kinds of floral appendages laterally at the successive nodes instead of leaves. Instead of leaves, the apex produces different kinds of floral appendages. Let us see what are that floral appendages laterally at a successive nodes instead of leaves. When a shoot tip transforms into a flower, now let us see that one shoot is going up and these at the sides there may be lateral leaves. When the shoot tip itself transforms into a flower, it is always solitary. The shoot tip, it is not branching further, it ends in the flower. When a shoot tip transforms into a flower, it is always a solitary. The arrangement of flowers on the floral axis is termed as inflorescence. You must know what is inflorescence. Inflorescence is a cluster of flowers. The arrangement of flowers on the floral axis is termed as inflorescence, depending on whether the apex gets converted into a flower or continues to grow. Sometimes this apex may stop in the flower, or sometimes apex may continuously grow, and at the sides, the flowers may develop. Laterally, in the axil, the flowers may develop. Depending on whether the apex gets converted into a flower or continues to grow, two major types of inflorescence are defined. So you must know which are these two major types of inflorescence. One is racemose and another one is cymose. You have two types of inflorescence, racemose and cymose. Now let us see what is racemose and what is cymose. So in racemose inflorescence, this is what racemose inflorescence. In racemose inflorescence, the main axis continues to grow. Main axis continues to grow. The flowers are borne laterally. See here, the main axis is continuing to grow. It is continuing to grow. But the flowers are borne laterally in an equipotent succession. That means, in an equipotent succession means old flower below, old flower at the bottom, and young flower at the top. Here, this is the youngest, and this is the oldest. Old flowers at the bottom and young flowers above. It is known as equipotent succession. So you must not remember, in the racemose type of inflorescence, the main axis continues to grow, main axis. In a cymose type of inflorescence, this is what a cymose type of inflorescence, the main axis terminates in a flower. Here you have seen the two branches. This branch terminates in a flower. This terminates in a flower. So, in a cymose type of inflorescence, the main axis terminates in a flower, hence is limited in growth. The flowers are born in basipetal order. So, here, the basipetal order. In the equipotent succession, the older flowers are at the bottom, young flowers at the top. Here, the old flower at the top, young flowers behind. This is old, young one behind. So this is what is known as cymose type of inflorescence. This is another important part that generally asked in board examination. What are the two types of inflorescence? Compare racemose type of inflorescence with that of cymose type of inflorescence. So, for the NEET or CET, you must know cymose, the alphabet that you have is a C. You just remember, in cymose type of inflorescence, main axis closes. Main axis won't grow further. It gets close with the flower. So, hence it's a limited growth. In biology, somehow you have to remember certain points by using your own mnemonics. Okay. Some alphabet you must always try to remember. So, racemose is the inflorescence where the main axis continuously grows. In cymose type of inflorescence, the main axis terminates. Main axis terminates in a flower. So, here it is the equipotent order, arrangement of flower in equipotent order, and here it is in a basipetal order. Now, let us look into the flower. The flower is the reproductive unit in angiosperms. It is meant for sexual reproduction. Flowers are meant for sexual reproduction. A typical flower has four different kinds of ovules arranged successively on the swollen end of the stalk or pedicel called thalamus or receptacle. I said flower is concerned with the sexual reproduction. A typical flower has four different kinds of ovules. Let us see what are these four different kinds of ovules arranged successively on the swollen part of the stalk. sewn on end of the stalk or pedicel called thalamus or receptacle. The four oars, different kinds of oars are, these are, different kinds of oars are calyx, corolla, andusium, gynecium. Gynecium. Calyx, corolla, andusium, and gynecium. Calyx and corolla are accessory organ, additional organ, while andusium and gynecium, these are reproductive organs. Out of these four oars, a typical flower has four different kinds of oars, namely calyx, corolla, andusium, and gynecium. Calyx and corolla are accessory organs, additional organs, and andusium and gynecium are reproductive organs. You can see here, you have some of the information here. In some flowers, like a sea lily, in some flowers, like a lily, what you see here? This is a lily, member of the family Liliaceae. In some flowers, like a lily, calyx, you can see green color, calyx, and corolla, you can see somewhat orange color. Calyx and corolla are not distinct, and are termed as a perianth. Then you cannot make out a separate calyx, separate corolla, and these others you come across, we are going to study about that also. We do have outermost overlook calyx, inner to that the overlook corolla. But here you cannot make out the calyx and corolla, they are not distinct, and we use the term in this condition perianth, and it is seen in lily. What is perianth? Perianth is the outer part of your flower consisting of the calyx and corolla. Consisting of calyx and corolla. So, the term tepal, T-E-P-A-L, the term tepal, tepal is a segment of the outer whorl in a flower that has no differentiation between petals and tepals. Wherever in a flower, you cannot make out outer whorl as a sepal whorl, that is the calyx, inner whorl of the petal, that's corolla. Where you cannot make out that, in that condition, we are using the term tepal. Tepal includes sepal as well as a petal. It is a tepal. Okay. So, otherwise, we also use the term perianth. Perianth is the outer part of the whorl, consisting of the calyx and corolla. When a flower has both andusium and gynecium in the same flower, it is called bisexual. A flower having either only stamens or only carpels is unisexual. Let us see what are the examples for bisexual and what are the examples for unisexual. So, a flower with both andusium and gynecium is a bisexual. A flower with only stamen or only carpel, that is a unisexual. Look here, this is what your hibiscus flower, and you know, it is otherwise commonly called China rose. China rose. In this hibiscus flower, you see the stamen and pistil are present on the same flower. So, hibiscus flower is an example for bisexual flower. And here, in a mustard flower, you see again the pistil and the stamen to occur in the same flower. So, mustard flower is also an example for bisexual flowers. Both these, hibiscus flower and mustard flower, are examples for bisexual flowers. Now, look into this. Corn, papaya, and cucumber. In this corn, papaya, cucumber, that the flowers are said to be unisexual. Unisexual. That means there are separate male flower and female flower. They are unisexual. Mustard, whatever you already heard, then rose, and also petunia. All these are examples for bisexual flowers. In bisexual flowers, as I have already told you, the stamen and the pistil are present in the same flower. In unisexual flower, they are present in different flowers. In symmetry, now, you have what is known as the symmetry. In symmetry, the flower may be actinomorphic or zygomorphic. That is based on the flower, arrangement of the flower in a symmetry, arrangement of the parts on either side. There are two types of flower. Flowers may be actinomorphic, showing radial symmetry, or zygomorphic, showing bilateral symmetry. Remember, Actinomorphic is also known as a radiosymmetry. Flower showing actinomorphic is said to be flower showing radiosymmetry, or zygomorphic is said to be showing bilateral symmetry. What are these? When a flower can be divided into two equal radial halves, when a flower can be divided into two equal radial halves in any plane, in any radial plane passing through the center, it is said to be actinomorphic. You take a flower and cut this flower, but anyway, if at all you cut this flower in any radial plane, if you can cut it into two equal halves, then it is known as the actinomorphic flower or flower showing radial symmetry. Which are the examples? Very, very important. Examples include mustard, datura, and chili. So mustard, datura, chili. These are the examples for the actinomorphic symmetry. When a flower can be divided into two similar halves only in one particular vertical plane, in one plane only, not in any plane, in one plane only, it is said to be zygomorphic, or it is said to show bilateral symmetry. Example, pea, gulmohar, bean, cassia. These are all examples for zygomorphic flower. Let us see. This, you can see, you can cut in any plane, you will get two equal halves. Any plane, two equal halves. Okay. Mustard flower, datura flower, chili flower, these are the one which show actinomorphic. These are the actinomorphic flower. As you know, actinomorphic flower is always called flower to show radial symmetry. You can cut along any radius, you will get two equal halves. And the examples are mustard flower, brassica, datura flower, and chili flower. Otherwise, it is called capsicum. Capsicum is the term for the chili flower, capsicum. So these all show what is known as the radial symmetry, or the flowers to show actinomorphic symmetry. So this is flower of peas or flower of gulmohar, which you can cut only in one plane to get to two equal halves, not in any plane. And these are examples for bilateral symmetry, or these are the flowers which are called zygomorphic flowers. Bean flower, zygomorphic. Cassia flower, also to show zygomorphic. Again, whatever examples you have, you must remember that are given in the NCERT book. What are the two types of flowers based on symmetry? That will be asked for 2 months or 3 months question. There is another type of flower, which are this flower does not show radial symmetry or bilateral symmetry, and on the other hand, it shows what is known as asymmetry. A flower is said to be asymmetric, irregular in symmetry, if it cannot be divided into two similar halves, it cannot be cut into two similar halves by any vertical plane passing through the center, as seen in what is known as a canna. In this canna, flowers of canna, you cannot cut the flower into two equal halves, either through radial or through bilateral, that plane of division, radial or bilateral. A flower may be trimerous, tetramerous, or pentamerous when the floral appendages are in multiple of 3, 4, or 5 respectively. Sometimes you see in some flowers, you see 3 sepals, 3 petals, etc. Then the flower is said to be trimerous. If there are 4 sepals, 4 petals, tetramerous. If there are 5, then it's also pentamerous. Let us look into that. This, what you have, trimerous. You can see this, 1, 2, 3, down below. 1, 2, 3, this is the below. 1, 2, 3, sepals, these are the 3 petals. And you do have here that of the endosium and gynecium. Okay, 3, 3. These are trimerous. This is that of a tetramerous. You can see sepal 1, 2, 3, 4, petals 1, 2, 3, 4, and also that of the stamens. So this is what is known as a tetramerous. And here you have pentamerous, hibiscus or China rose, pentamerous. So depending upon how many sepals are there, how many petals are there, you have trimerous, tetramerous, and pentamerous. Flowers with the bracts, reduced leaf, found at the base of the pedicel are called bracteate. So this is a flower. You have a bract there. So the flower with the bract, which is nothing but reduced leaf, found at the base of the pedicel. Reduced leaf found at the base of the pedicel. Pedicel are called bracteate. And those without bracts are called ebracteate. It is just like the leaf stipulate or e-stipulate here, bracteate and ebracteate. So flowers with the leaf-like structure at the base of the pedicel, this is the pedicel, stalk of the flower, at the base of the pedicel, it is known as the bracteate. Based on the position of calyx, corolla, and andrusium, in respect of the ovary on thalamus, the flowers are described as hypogynous, perigynous, epigynous. This is a very, very important part, and generally you get a doubt and you commit mistake. And this question is generally asked for 5 marks. 5 marks. Now, the question here is, based on the position of the calyx, corolla, and the endosium, with respect to ovary of thalamus, describe the different types of flowers. So these are the different types of flowers. What? Based on what? Based on position of calyx, corolla, and endosium in respect of the ovary on the thalamus. This is the thalamus and this is the ovary. Thalamus, ovary. You are looking into the position of sepal, petal, and endosium on one hand, and comparing the position of this sepal, petal, and endosium, comparing with that of the ovary on the thalamus. Based on the position of the calyx, corolla, and endosium, in comparison with the ovary on the thalamus, the flowers are described as hypogynous, then you have perigynous and epigynous. Hypogynous, perigynous, and epigynous. So these are the three types of flowers. Now let us see what is meant by hypogynous flower, what is meant by perigynous flower, and what is meant by epigynous flower. Based on the position, as I already told you, based on the position of the calyx, look here, where is the calyx, where is the petal, where is the endosium? With respect to ovary on the thalamus, the flowers are described as hypogynous, perigynous, epigynous, right? Now, let us see. I will come back, if at all you want. I will come back to this. In the hypogynous flower, gynecium occupies highest position. Gynecium occupies highest position. While all other parts, which are other parts? Sepal, petal, and endosium, these are situated below the gynecium. This is the gynecium, female part, gynecium. So, sepal, petal, and the endosium, when they are situated below the gynecium, condition is called hypogynous. So, we are comparing the position of sepal, petal, and endosium in relation to gynecium. If all these parts are situated below the gynecium, the condition said to be hypogynous. In the hypogynous flower, the gynecium occupies the highest position. While the other parts are situated below it. In these cases, ovary is such flower, he is said to be superior, because ovary is above. Superior means above. Ovary is superior. What are the examples? Examples include mustard, China rose, and brinjal. Mustard, China rose, and brinjal are the examples for hypogynous. Now, if gynecium is situated in the center, look here, gynecium is situated in the center, and other parts of flower are located at the rim of the thalamus, almost at the same level, then the condition is said to be perigynous. That means these sepal, petal, and endosium are situated peri means outer to the gynecium, outer, surrounding the gynecium, peri, outer to the gynecium, or surrounding the gynecium, or in line with the gynecium, then the condition is said to be perigynous. Flower is called perigynous. In the perigynous, the ovary here is said to be half inferior. Here, superior. Here, half inferior. Example includes plum, rose, peach. Plum, rose, peach are the examples for perigynous flower with the half inferior ovary. In epigynous flowers, epigynous, all the other parts are above the gynous. In epigynous flowers, the margin of the thalamus grows upward, enclosing the ovary completely and getting fused with it. The other parts of flower arise above the ovary. Other parts of the flower arise above the ovary. Both these are perigynous. So, in epigynous flower, the margin of the thalamus grows upward. And endosium, the petal and sepal are present above the ovary. Therefore, the condition is epigynous. So, this is epigynous flower, and ovary here is below. So, it is known as inferior ovary. And example includes guava, cucumber, and ray florets of sunflower. What is most important here in this particular case is, that of the term, meaning of the term, hypogynous, perigynous, epigynous, and position of the ovary, and examples for this. Therefore, it is very important to ask for 5 marks question. Now, you see what you see here. You see here. This is what is known as the hypogynous. Hypogynous flower, hypogynous. All these, that is sepal, the petal, and the endosium are situated. This is ovary, below the ovary. Hence the name hypo. Hypo means below, gynous, sepal, gynosium, below the ovary. Hypogynous, you must remember that. In hypogynous flower, ovary is superior. In perigynous, they are in the same line. You can see ovary, the sepal, the petal, and the endosium. It surrounds the ovary. Perigynous. In epigynous, the sepal, the petal, and gynosium are present above the ovary. Therefore, it is epigynous, and ovary is said to be inferior. And here, ovary is said to be half inferior. So, as I told you, you must know the example for hypogynous flower with the superior ovary, mustard, China, rose, and brinjal. This you have to buy heart. There is no other go. You have to buy heart. You make one column, make one chart, write what is hypogynous, what is type of ovary, what are the examples, and write what is perigynous, type of ovary, and examples. You must write explanation for hypogynous. You must write a description for the perigynous. You must write a description for the epigynous. And also you should tell what is the position of the other parts in comparison to that of the ovary. What type of ovary come across? What are the examples? This is the best beautiful piece of work so that you can easily remember. So that's all about the today's class. And we are going to cover with this part in our next class. And it is the time, if at all you have any doubts, to clarify the doubts. Right? Or you can just look into that. In its parts of a flower, each flower normally is a four floral ovules, calyx, andrium, calyx, corolla, andrium, ganicium. This is what? The calyx, outermost, then inner to red is corolla, inner to red is andrium, inner to red is ganicium. These are the four parts of the flower. Four parts of the flower. Okay, so we are going to cover our next part in our next class. So let me meet you in the next period. Okay? Any doubt, if at all you have any doubt, you can ask the doubt.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select Biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IITPAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon that is GyanChat. GyanChat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. GyanChat Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon, and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number, of the Kindle version of H.C. Verma book. On clicking OK it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app. where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello, my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions. And I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT book. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that are given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom. Under basis of classification, what we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals, that is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of difference in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. In relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or
ecosystem. We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.